Okay, let's talk about some general principles. In this game, six players take on the role of six major powers: the Ottomans, Habsburg, England, France, the Papacy, and the Protestants. Players will play cards during their turn in the action phase, and you can play cards similar to Twilight Struggle, either for the point value or for the event. But there are five different types of cards. So the first type of card is the home card. This is a card that is specific to a power and you will get back once you play it. The second type of card is mandatory event card. This card is a card that you must play for the event, and you can also, you will get the points a value afterwards as well. This is an example of a standard card. It's got an event and a point value. Some cards, as you notice at the bottom, have the remove from play. So you'll have to remove those specific ones from play after you've played them. And there are response cards, which you can play out of turn in response to specific things that your opponents are doing. And finally, there are combat cards that you can play during combat. This is, in particular, is a card that shows why mercenaries are so much cheaper than regular troops and why you should be very careful about hiring mercenaries as the backbone of your army. Looking at the map, there are four different types of spaces. The circles are just regular cities. The hexagons, present only in Germany, are called electorates. The eight-pointed stars are called fortifications. And the most important territories are called keys. They are squares. They are both fortified and politically significant. As the papal player controls other territories, we use the hexagonal control markers to denote control of spaces that are not keys. And if the papal player were to conquer Florence, we put another square control marker on Florence. As keys are conquered, players earn both higher values of cards drawn and victory points. And this is important because now we're going to talk about victory conditions. There are several ways to win the game. There are some conditions that are automatic. In this case, if we were to control and place these square control markers all on the board, we would automatically win as the papal player. The other conditions are checked during the check victory condition step, and they are the standard victory, which is when somebody gets to 25 points, domination, when somebody has 5 more points than any other player, and then the time limit. After 9 turns, whoever has the most points will win the game. The game is divided into phases. And the first phase that you will do recurrently is the card draw phase. You will see that in this phase you add leaders and religious leaders and debate reformers to the game based on the turn track. The second phase is the diplomacy phase. This diplomacy player aid also illustrates impulse order, which is Ottomans, Habsburg, English, French, Papacy, and Protestants. And this is the order in which the game will be played. You also see the minor powers, and it's an easy reference for how many points you have to spend to declare war on another power. So during the diplomacy phase, there's many different steps. First, this is the only time where you can conduct secret talks. There are certain agreements that are binding and that change the board condition at the time in which they entered. You can conduct alliances, you can sue for peace, you can ransom leaders, or you can declare war according to this table. The spring deployment phase. In this phase, powers can, in impulse order, deploy units from their capital to any other friendly space. In the action phase, on your turn, you can either play a card for its command points, play a card as an event, or pass. You may not pass unless you have played all your mandatory cards and you have played your home card as well. The leader, Henry VIII, he has a battle rating of 1, he has a command rating of 8 units, but most importantly, he can save one card from action phase to action phase. In the draw phase, he draws an extra card. The maximum amount of units that can be on a space is 4. This can be modified by if you have a leader. He has a command rating of 6, which means that if he is the only leader in the space, the stacking limit is 6. The battle rating is 1, which means he can add 1 battle dice to battles in which he's participating. If there are 2 leaders in a space, you add their command rating. So in this case, Dudley and Henry VIII would allow for 14 units to be present in a space. Notice that these units are regulars with the solid red layer at the bottom, and these units are mercenaries. So we would have 6 units of regulars and 2 units of mercenaries. It doesn't matter whether the picture is an infantry unit or an artillery unit, the number is what is relevant. You're also limited by components in the game. Line of communication is important for many things, but in particular for sieges. Power has a line of communication to a space if it can trace a path of spaces and sea zones from the space you are starting to a friendly controlled fortified space that is a home space for the power or one of its allies. So it means that you have line of communication if you can trace a line from any space on the board to a fortified space, which are the squares or the pointed stars. But that must be a home space for you or one of your allies. So if the English were to conquer Paris, Paris is not a home space for them, so they could not trace line of communications back to Paris. For 1 point, you can move a formation across clear path, which is these lines. For 2 points, you can move a formation over a pass. A pass, recall, is these dotted lines. These are the mountains. 1 point is a naval move. A naval move allows you to move all your naval units to the adjacent spaces. You can also transport your land units using naval units. The maximum amount of units that can do this is 5. So even if you have a leader and you have 6, you can still transport 5. You must have ships in each territory, and it costs you 1 movement point for each space you cross plus the landing space. So it will be 1, 2, 3 if you wanted to land in Bordeaux. You cannot land if there is an enemy ship inside the port, and you cannot stop and see halfway through the movement. You must finish your movement from land on land. During movement, enemy units can be intercepted if you roll a 9 with some modifiers. And if you are being attacked in an unfortified spaces, you can try to evade once again by trying to roll a 9 with some modifiers. You can recruit units at a cost of 1 for mercenaries, 2 for regular troops, and 2 for naval squadrons. You can recruit them in your home spaces. That's, once again, spaces that are your home color. You can control unfortified spaces, so spaces in which you are in or adjacent and which are unfortified and free from enemy troops. You can control them. Battles are fought automatically when 2 or more enemy units share a space. Assuming that the battle takes place in an unfortified space. If the battle takes place in a fortified space, then the defender has the option to retreat into the fortification. The fortification holds maximum 4 units. In that case, the attacker has to wait 1 turn to then resolve the assault on the fortification and the siege the next turn by spending 1 additional command point. The piracy action is unique to the Ottomans, and it's a way for them to use their unique unit, the Corsair, to pirate adjacent ports and gain either cards, victory points, or destroy enemy ships. We want to make the distinction between political control and religious influence. In the 1517 scenario, we start with all of Germany being under Habsburg control, and with these control markers placed on the solid side up, meaning they are under Catholic influence. The other side is a white side up, which means they are under Protestant influence. This is true of the other control markers as well. English under Protestant influence or under Catholic influence. The beginning of the game will start with some Reformation attempts, which is also another action that the Protestant player can do under the published treaty. This, you pick a space that is adjacent to a Protestant influence. The game starts as soon as Martin Luther enters Wittenberg. Wittenberg becomes Protestant. You pick an adjacent space. And based on some modifiers, you roll a certain amount of dice. Plus one for each reformer adjacent, plus one for each adjacent troop, Protestant troop, plus one for each adjacent Protestant territory. And then the papal player rolls similarly, plus one for each adjacent Catholic, plus one for each adjacent Catholic troop, etc. If you have Catholic troop in the territory, it's plus two. If you have a Protestant troop in the territory, it's plus two. If you have a reformer in the territory, it's also plus two. You roll to see who got the highest number. And in case of a tie, the Protestant wins, and so on. This would be one attempt. Publishing a treaty normally gives you two attempts and can be modified by certain reformers. Another religious action that you can do is to translate the scripture. There is the New Testament and the full Bible, and it comes three languages, the French Bible, the English Bible, and the German Bible. Every action point that you spend moves the marker forward, and when you reach to the end, you can make six Reformation attempts in that language zones. And then you can move the counter to the full Bible, again, make some Reformation rolls. Another religious action that you can do is to call a theological debate. A theological debate is a roll-off between debaters. It is not affected by board state. It is not affected by adjacency of territories, by troops. It is simply a roll-off, and the difference in roll-off will allow the victor to flip that many spaces to his religious influence. This is the Protestant space track. It shows how many spaces are under Protestant control. At the end of the game, the papal player will get the number in purple, which is the left one, and the Protestant player will get the number in brown, which is the right one. Notice there's an auto-win condition if 50 spaces become under Protestant influence. The papal player can also burn books, which is the equivalent of publishing a treaty. That allows him to do some counter-reformation attempts. This is an important event for the Protestant player. It is a mandatory event. It can come as early as turn two. It is automatically played in the winter phase of turn four. Prior to the Schmalkaldic League, the Protestant player cannot build any military units, cannot move any military units. Also, nobody else can declare war on the Protestant units, and other powers' units may not move or retreat into electorate spaces. Prior to this card having taken effect, whenever an electorate is converted to Protestant influence, the corresponding unit is placed in that electorate, aiding conversion of other adjacent. After this card takes effect, all spaces that are under Protestant influence now become under Protestant political control. So this would change this way. And units, upon conversion, are only added from the electorate to the map if the Protestant player has political control of this space. From that point on, the Habsburgs and the Protestants are now at war, and the papacy and the Protestants are also now at war. There are three New World actions. They are explore, colonize, and conquer. France, England, and the Habsburg can do all these. Explore is primarily a way of gaining victory points. Colonize and conquer can allow you to conquer civilization or form colonies and have the possibilities of giving you income of cards according to this table.